on deck would be the 2012 Comprehensive Annual Financial Report by Mr. Burke, who's a CPA partner, Sherry Burkhardt and Tom, and Ms. Judkins. My first question is going to be, is it Kafer or Kafer?
Kafer.
Thank you.
President Samuel, Vice President Robinson, members of council, and Chairman Judkins, the Deputy CAO of Finance and Administration. If you allow me, I'll set the stage for the presentations that will follow relative to the Comprehensive Annual Financial Report for fiscal year ending June 30, 2012. As you know, Section 8.10 of the City Charter requires an annual independent financial audit of all accounts, books, records, and financial transactions of the city by either the auditor or public accounts of the Commonwealth or by an independent firm certified public accountant. The independent auditors of Cherry Becker and Holland, a certified public accounting firm, will fulfill that requirement, has fulfilled that requirement, and they will be reporting out on their audit of our financial statements. In doing so, they have rendered an unqualified opinion stating that the city's financials for FY 2012 ended June 30th are fairly presented and conformed with generally accepted accounting principles. So we have with us members of the firm today, Sarah Guelo.
Did I get that right?
Close enough, okay. And Eddie Burke, they're both here. And I'm going to ask them to come forward as they assist us in presenting the CAFR. Following them will be a more detailed presentation by Wayne Lesser, who's our interim finance director. He will come forward and provide you with a very informative financial handout. And additionally, he will give you the financial results for 2012. So, Eddie, can you come forward?
Good afternoon. Can everyone hear me? We have provided you a handout. Mine is not color, but it should be the bound report. Okay. That's being handed out right now. I'll give you just a second to receive that.
While that's being passed around, is there a soft copy to be provided also?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. If you would, if you would turn to page 3, what I'm doing here today is I want to cover 4 major areas, and Wayne will be addressing the actual numbers. First, the status of the audit. Secondly, the results. There's required communications that I'm going to be providing today, and this is just some general observations about the audit. You would turn to page 5, section 1. As far as the status of the audit, we have completed the audit of the CAFR for the year ending June 30, 2012. We conducted our audit in accordance with government auditing standards and the guidelines specified by the APA. The reason I bring that up is because of the statutes in the state of Virginia and because of the various funding sources that you have. You are required to have an audit under government auditing standards. That is a step higher as far as the standards are concerned, other than just regular commercial enterprises. You did receive an unqualified opinion on your financial statements. That is the highest level assurance that a CPA firm can provide on a set of statements. And in layman's terms, we believe that the statements can be relied upon by this board, citizens, and the various fundings agencies that provide you funds and the organizations that loan you money. Our purpose in the audit is to form an opinion on the financial statements, and the objective is to provide reasonable assurance that the financial statements as presented can be relied upon by third parties. There's a lot of information that we request throughout the audit process. All the information that we did request throughout this process was provided to us, and the finance department did provide cooperation with us throughout the audit process. As a part of the audit, we did look at the internal control environment of city. Basically, the organization from the top all the way down to transactions. The purpose of that process was to get an understanding of the organizational structure in the city, and also the control that's in place and how you process your receipts, disbursements, your billings, and all that to allow us to develop an audit plan in regards to our audit. We turn to the next page, page six, the results. The audit process started several months ago, and the process has taken several months to complete. We actually started this process by sitting down with management and laying out our audit plan for the year, also addressing any new reporting standards that need to be addressed when we were reporting on this year. There was a number of areas that we paid this special attention. Not all inclusive, we did more things than this. Your cash investment areas, accounts receivable and revenues, property and equipment, accounts payable and expenses, litigation and estimates, we spent quite a bit of time on. We did a lot of confirmation work, a lot of verification, recalculations to verify that the numbers that's presented in the financial statements could be relied upon. We looked in the litigation area, we actually contacted the attorney, looking for areas whether or not something needed to be approved in the financial statements, and also whether or not there were any particular areas that needed to be disclosed. In addition to that, we looked at your various estimates that were used in the financial statements. The four primary ones was the allowance for doubtful accounts, property and equipment in regards to methods that you use to depreciate capital assets, liabilities related to pensions and other post-employment obligations, and then your self-insurance liabilities. What we were doing there is there's a lot of assumptions and estimates that are used in preparing the liabilities that are eventually reported in the financial statements. We looked at those and made sure they were consistent with the prior year and the methodology that we used to follow the guidelines prescribed by the standards. You return to page seven from a required communication perspective. A couple of years ago, there was a new reporting standard, an auditing standard that came out with SAS 115, having to do with internal control findings and how they are to be reported. There were three basic areas that we have to address as a CPA firm and as your independent auditor. One, whether or not there were any material weaknesses. Second category is significant deficiencies. And third is deficiencies in internal controls. From the financial statement side of the house, in the control environment, we did not identify any significant deficiencies or material weaknesses for the year ended June 30, 2012. Section A for page A, required communications. Annually, we are required to report to the governing body certain things, one being the various accounting policies, whether or not there were any change in the accounting policies used by the city. The city did adopt and implement two new reporting standards this year, GASB Statement 56 and GASB Statement 62. They really did not have any material impact on your financial statements. From a change in accounting policy perspective, there was a prior period adjustment that was reported in the financial statements, having to do with the values that was put on land and buildings. This was actually a process that started a couple of years ago, and you may know last year there was a prior period adjustment that was reported. This year, the Internal Audit Department, with the help of the APA and the Finance Department, actually sat down as a group and came up with a methodology that was going to be followed to try to address this in the current year. We sat in on those meetings, we came up with a methodology. Finance actually implemented that, came up with the new number that we felt was reliable. The Internal Audit Department also agreed with that. We also signed up on that, and then with prior period adjustment to adjust the land and buildings, what we felt like is a good number for the city moving forward. And just so you'll know that the net effect of all those entries that were made, the land and buildings were actually written up $13.7 million when everything was said and done overall. From a journal entry perspective, there were no proposed journal entries, no past adjusting journal entries that were proposed by us. There were no disagreements with management. The only issue that we did discuss that I would like to bring to your attention was the fixed asset issue. We did sit down with the internal audit department and management about that to come up with a methodology as how we want to be addressing that moving forward. And then from an overall observation perspective, this has to do with capital assets and the working of the internal audit department with finance department. That was good collaboration between those two departments, we felt. They both sat down along with us, coming up with a good methodology that was going to be followed. We would encourage the departments to continue to work together moving forward, along with the other departments within the city, to try to work together and try to make this process be more effective and more efficient moving forward. And that concludes my comments at this time. And I'll be happy to answer any questions, or I'll turn this over to Wayne, and I'll go through the more detailed specifics of the numbers and the financial statements.
Thank you. Are there any questions at this point on the presentation we received?
Appreciate the presentation. Thank you very much. We'll certainly look forward to a little bit more detailed information in regards to the values, the asset values that we had challenges with last year's to the methodology of how we were creating those. But my question is, we had hoped that we would have gotten the capital done much earlier in the year. Is there any recommendations that you would make to us as it relates to the length of time that it takes to have this report completed, and whether there are other steps that we should take to try to have it done before January?
This was actually a carryover from when the gas report was 2002. Actually, in 2002 was when this really became an issue. And quite honestly, when 34 came into play, there was not really a lot of good guidelines out there as how to do some of this. And as 34 has been matured over time, there have been better methodologies and better processes used to come up with estimates. And all of these are estimates, too. A lot of this property was given to the city, and coming up with those values is, quite frankly, just not an easy process. So I think what they have in place now, the biggest problem was just getting a good list. And I think they've gone through and developed a good process as to coming up with a good list and a good method that was used to put values on that. It's really a tracking moving forward with whatever is given or deleted moving forward. So it should not be an issue.
Yes, thank you. And maybe if this is going to be addressed by one of the subsequent speakers, and I can wait until then, I'm understanding that there's going to be a change in accounting policy such that the future retirement liability will be dropped onto the bottom line for an organization. So have you or had some discussion with us in finance such that as we, especially as we're gearing up for our biennial budget, some projection that allows us to accurately as you can project the liability over the next biennial period, so what we're building in is consistent with just the liability for that period versus all of the future plus what we're carrying. So that was a big question, I know. So if somebody else asked that.
I can talk, that's actually GASB 67 and 68. I think the effective date is that 2014 and 2015.
So
you've got a couple of years out, but you are exactly right. It's going to require the retirement, unfunded retirement obligation to be reported along with the OPEB obligation. So to answer your question, yes, there's been a number of conversations, and actually the internal audit department is looking at that also along with the finance department. So yes, that's being looked at.
So you're saying that we won't have I think we'll have more discussion about that. I'm sure
yes. Comes
to what we're doing. But you're saying officially that's going to affect until 2014.
14 and 15.
14.
Yes.
Thank you.
Other questions?
Thank you, Mr. President.
I don't really have a question.
question right now, but I noticed as I went through this, there were some revenue projections that were millions of dollars above what we did, and some revenue projections that were millions of dollars below. I just would ask the Committee of the Finance Committee to have a little bit of an explanation as to why that occurs.
Mr. Lassiter is actually going to address that at his presentation.
All right. I believe Mr. Lassiter may have a word for you, sir. And as always, Mr. Lassiter, soft copies, we love that, I'm sure you do as well.
So thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
You just received two handouts, backing up. You've just received two handouts. One is a single page, and the other is a multi-page document labeled 2012 capital results. The single page document is a crosswalk from the fourth quarter financial report that you received back in August. That was a preliminary projection of year-end results. At that time, we projected where we thought the numbers would end up, with the caveat that we had a number of rules and year-end journal entries that had not been made, so we knew those numbers would change. We just didn't know to what extent. Everybody got their copies?
Yes.
Starting at the top of that single-page document, the crosswalk, you'll see that the very top projection is the reported as of the report that we showed. We showed the revenue and expenses for the resulting surplus of $10.9 million. The section right under that, the actual audit results, shows that the revenue came in lower than was projected. Expenses also came in lower, giving us a net surplus of $4.2 million as opposed to $10.9. Now, what makes up that difference of both the revenue and the expenditures is the third section you see there, which shows revenue had a difference of 19.8. Was down $19.8 million, what was projected. And the biggest part of that was when the budget is developed, some revenues are, in this case, with this budget, were transferred from the fiscal 11 over into fiscal 12. They're brought in for budgetary purposes. They are not new revenue coming in, so they really can't be coming in or brought in as a new revenue. In the fourth quarter report, they were shown as revenue, when they really should not have been. So that explains a large variance in the revenue side there. In the footnote there B, the section that shows the $13 million favorable variance on expenses, you can see that $5.4 million were expenses that had to be rolled into the new year. They were encumbrances. The money was not actually spent. So they were rolled from 12 and 13. Whereas in the report, we assume they would be spent and reported in 12. The second item is a risk management item that we thought we were going to have a liability of $3 million. We showed that in the report, but as it turned out, we had a favorable $3 million transaction, so that's a $6 million swing right there. And then the third item was some additional savings in various departments totaling $4.7 million. All those three items totaled the $13 million favorable difference in the expense variation. Then at the bottom of that sheet, you'll see a reconciliation of the fund balance. You may recall last year we reported that it was a Now, like I said, that's what I just went over with you is a reconciliation, not the budget, but the fourth quarter report you last received from us back in August to the actual year-end results and capital. The second handout you were given, the multi-page document, is basic information on the capital in summary form, and I won't go through there and read it to you, but I hope that it would perhaps answer questions you might have or help you develop questions that you'd like us to answer specifically. We'll certainly be glad to do that. I do want to say that on Friday of last week, we received a multi-page document from your chief of staff, which were some suggested items that your financial analyst had come up with, saying that council may want to ask questions about those items. We're going through that document this time to develop responses. Some of those we already have. In fact, some of those items we even addressed in the fourth quarter report. But a suggestion that we had and gave back to the chief of staff and was warmly received is that we set up a workshop with at least the management analysts from council staff and the finance staff, and we welcome any council members who would like to join that. But in that, I would envision that we'd go through the capital. We'd have a detailed look at where the numbers come from, what they mean, how they relate to each other, so that we all have a better understanding of this complex financial report for capital, and maybe help us all in that process. So that's our offer. We hope it will be accepted by council.
Thank you, Mr. Russell. Are there questions of council? Vice President Robinson.
Thank you very much. I think that I want to commend you and Ms. Lugali and working with the council members as well as our staff. I think the joint work session would be ideal. It's something that we've talked about on many different occasions. Sometimes it's difficult. We get caught up in the budget cycle and you know, we sidetrack this to sitting aside and having the time. And I want to thank the staff for the questions that they sent. And I do respect the fact that they were late receiving on Friday, and so you have not had a chance to respond to those. But I would strongly encourage that we have this work session and that. We have the opportunity to have a better appreciation for what is actually happening. The additional request that I would have likewise though is that we have already adopted several papers that where there were funds from the budget year of this CAFA that have been appropriated for expenditures for the current budget year that we're working on. And one of the challenges that we have frequently had to deal with as it relates to the end of the year fund balance and the reappropriation of those funds for uses. And most times, before we have an actual dollar audited fund balance, as what the CAFA provides us, there are appropriation papers for the use of those funds prior to. And I must say that I heard you making mention of some of those funds that have been identified that were going to be used and were appropriated. It was talked about during the budget process for this current budget year. And I was split between two conversations, so I'm sure I missed something critical. But that piece of us being able to have the second quarterly report, which is the end of December, that help us to see how the end of the year fund balance appropriations are already appropriated prior to us receiving the CAFA, as well as prior to us receiving the second quarterly report, and the impact that it has as well as I would really like that to be a part of that discussion because we've talked on different occasions about perhaps the fiscal policies that need to be in place to help mediate that in a better way.
We'll certainly try to make that happen, and we're going to try to have the report to you on time, which I believe is 45 days after the end of the report.
Thank you. Are there other questions by council at this point?
just a point of clarification that you were suggesting that we would have, Mr. President Weiss, a subsequent conversation and a workshop that would include us all. Is that accurate?
It would
be a forum that...
It would definitely include council staff and interested council members. I think that's the way it's classified.
It is, but I would say that not just the new council members, we welcome any and all of them.
Any.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions at this point? Thank you, Mr. Weiss. Oh, sorry, Mr. Krasnoff.
Sorry. Thank you. Mr. Lassner, I'm making some sense of all the budget. I see that we've had these unassigned fund balances from year to year. The prior fiscal year, 2011, about 10% of the total budget was unassigned balance at the end of the year. This report showed 9%. Do we have a goal that we're trying to meet, because we know that we have a high variable of what our potential revenues and our potential expenses might be, so we're working for some target. I know we're trying to build up fund balance so that we can improve the bond ratings. Can you explain what our goals might be for surplus and how we're positioned?
That's a great question, actually. Just this year, council passed a paper that changed the formula a little bit of how the fund balance, what the equation is for calculating the fund balance, and that's what drove it from a slightly higher percentage to a slightly lower one this year. The fund balance did not go down. As you saw in the report, it actually went up by $8.8 million. We do have a target of 10% minimum on the unassigned fund balance. The fund balance, I don't know where you are with it, but the bond rating agencies, it's sacred territory for them, that you have that in case of a financial disaster in the city, you have a source of revenue to go to. It is strongly recommended that you not touch that unless you are in one of the prescribed areas, but back to your basic question. 10% is our minimum balance, and we would hope to be there very soon. We're striving to get there.
Follow up on that. Back to Councilwoman's Google point on pension liabilities and bond rating and these unassigned fund balances. That's going to create an impact on bond rating when we start adding on new liabilities. So do we need to be concerned about the metric, or do you feel like the 10% is a good metric right now to satisfy that future liability of the pensions?
Well, I think the 10% is a fine number. Of course, the equation is going to change when you bring in that additional liability. So we'll have to get closer to the time to find out exactly what the impact might be. We acknowledge that is going to be a sizable liability to the former balance sheet. But I think as far as answer your question about the percentage, I think a 10% unassigned fund balance would be a respectable amount even after that.
Thank you.
One more comment if I may. I mentioned that the change of calculation on the fund balance, the formula, we in the paper that council passed this year, we count the revenue on the general fund side as well as the schools funding that comes from the state. That's what it's calculated on. It's a pretty simple calculation. I just didn't want you to think that because the percentage went down, the amount went down, not the case at all.
So we will be working with our chief of staff to find a potential work session opportunity, but also those questions, you will answer those and send them back to us.
The ones on the list we received from?
Yes,
absolutely.
Thank you. How long do you think you need?
We should have those pretty wrapped up this week, I would say.
Look forward to seeing by this time.
Now, I do want to say, as far as the meeting goes, I got today the names of your